In these lectures, I've argued that what we should be analysing Homeric and Hesiodic poems in terms of is what they were doing in the real world. Doing, in one sense, means their enactment in performance, how the rhapsode used his body, his cloak and his staff to embody the story that he was telling, giving audience members a sensory and emotional as well as a purely intellectual connection to the narrative. But the doing also refers to the poem's cultural function, what ideological work they were undertaking, how they participated in the Nazcan project of defining Greekness. In particular, I've argued that they function as a counterweight to the colonial project. As satellite colonies were being sent out, as Greeks were mingling in every sense with non-Greeks across the Mediterranean, the Homeric and Hesiodic poems tensed against the centrifugal drift by providing a strong narrative of rootedness and peninsular identity, embodied in particular in the married couple. The marriage of Odysseus and Penelope, and in a less systematically developed way that of Helen and Menelaus, encapsulate the resistance to intermarriage with foreigners and the emotional appeal of marrying within the kinship group. This complex of ideas associating the family, the household, and the land, I've argued, is embodied in particular in the imagery of the rhapsode staff, this visible reminder of the upright family tree and its connection to the soil of Greece. In this lecture, I want to zoom out a little and think about the wider context. I want to begin by thinking a little bit more about the role that Homer and Hesiod have adopted in modern scholarship. Then I want to consider in more detail why it might have been that these particular texts achieved the kind of cultural dominance that they did in Greece. And finally, I want to consider the longer-term effects of the adoption of Homeric and Hesiodic epics. When we look at the Homeric poems in particular from all these different angles, I hope we can begin to see what the limitations of our existing conceptions are and how we might get beyond them. So, to begin with the constructions of modern scholarship. In particular, I think we need to get to grips with the role that Homer plays in modern, criticism, we need to think through the relationship between Homer and the Bible, which I want to argue still shapes our response to the Iliad and the Odyssey. Now, the analogy between Homer and the Bible was often drawn in antiquity itself. First, Alexandrian Jews developed allegorical methods calqued on those of Homeric exegetes, a process brilliantly explored recently by Maron Niehoff. Then in Christian late antiquity, the direction of traffic was reversed, and Homer began to be reinvented as a vehicle for sacred truths on the analogy of the Bible. Plotinus, Porphyry, who was particularly hostile to Christians, and Proclus claimed that the polytheist Greek tradition, and above all the Odyssey, yielded greater insight into cosmic truths than the Bible did. But in the 21st century, we are heirs to a more recent set of transformations. As is now widely understood, classical philology emerged as a discipline in tension with theology. From the 18th century onwards, European scholars found Homer and the Bible an increasingly awkward double act. For sure, they had much in common as the two primal wellsprings of European civilization. So Matthew Arnold, for example, compared them for their unvarnished lucidity and suggested the King James Version of the Bible as the best repository for vocabulary for anyone who wanted to translate the Homeric texts. Modern Homeric philology, though, was born out of the conflict between the sacred and the classical, a conflict that had its roots in the Protestant Reformation. Philological method, in particular, could be deeply threatening when applied to venerable texts. 18th century German philologists had argued that books of the Hebrew Bible were composite, multiply authored texts. Such approaches, and particularly Richard Eichhorn's Einleitung ins Alte Testamentum, were influential on Friedrich August Wolff, whose prolegomena to the study of Homer of 1795 initiated the modern era of Homeric studies. Wolff's argument was that the variety of dialectical oddities and hapax legomena and a positive narrative coherence showed that the Iliad and the Odyssey were not actually unified poems, but compilations of originally distinct episodes. Now, it's hard to get a feel for the radical force of this kind of argument from the 21st century, which is so comfortable with the aesthetics of fragmentation and incoherence, since, of course, 20th century modernism set its stall out in precisely these terms to resist the idea of the coherent. But in the 18th and 19th centuries, any argument against the unity of either the Bible or Homer was felt as a threat to the unity of sacred text in general, and thus as a radical and subversive gesture that threatened the bedrock of civilization as a whole. In 1847, an English reviewer of Carl Lachmann, who'd been a disciple of Thorpe's, a reviewer who rejoiced in the Harry Potter-esque name of John Gibson Lockhart, wrote in the Quarterly Review that, I'm quoting, "The doctrine revived and developed by Wolff as to Homer was an offset from the determined warfare against the Bible, which throughout the last century occupied so many of the liveliest intellects of Europe. Homer has not unjustly been called, by Wolff himself, the Bible of the Greeks, and it would be easy to show in how many ways the anti-Christian conspiracy might have hoped to see its proper object forwarded by the collateral, however in many cases undersigned, cooperation of those who essayed to shape everything that had for thousands of years been accepted as the origin, construction, and authority of the literary monument, which approached nearest in claims of antiquity to the Hebrew scriptures, and had exerted an influence only inferior to theirs on the religious beliefs of nations, besides directing and governing, far more than any other writings whatsoever, the general sentiment and taste of the cultivated world." Now, the fear that scripture would be contaminated with the infection of Homeric philology was encapsulated in a phrase apparently coined by Colonel William Muir, whose name now is barely known, but who was in the mid-19th century one of the best-known Anglophone scholars of Homer. In the second edition of his Critical History of the Language and Literature of Ancient Greece, Muir attacked what he called the Wolffian heresy, a resonant label that spread very quickly across the English-speaking world, including to Samuel Butler, who used the phrase in the opening pages of the authoress of the Odyssey. The phrase Wolffian heresy implied not just that Wolff's methods were heretical because they could be cross-applied to the Bible, but even that the Homeric poems themselves were a kind of sacred text, which only the sacrilegious would dare to dissect with the philological scalpel. In the 20th century, the debate was sharpened by the impact, of course, of Milman Parry and Albert Lord and their research on the South Slavic Guzlan tradition. Parry and Lord discovered, famously, the oral formula, a unit of verse that an oral performer can drop into a metrically rigid line at a convenient point. What followed from this was that the presence in a song, such as the Iliad and the Odyssey, of such formulae was a clear sign that the poems were composed orally. What's more, this model suggests that there was originally no one Homeric script, no single coherent text, but that every performance brought with it a new version of the same song, just as the Slavic Guzlars could claim to be singing the same song, even when the details were demonstrably different from performance to performance. Now this, I don't need to overemphasize it, this was the decisive shift in Homeric studies in the 20th century, and created a rift that survives today between oralists, scholars like Edward Bakker, Barbara Graziosi and Gregory Nagy, who can hold a wide range of beliefs, but all ultimately commit to the idea that the poems testify to a vibrant and open-ended oral culture that persisted late into the archaic period. And on the other hand, the so-called scriptists, like Martin West and Barry Powell, who argue for the decisive role of writing in the formation of the archaic epics. Now, in the aftermath of the First World War, when Lord and Parry were writing, a war, of course, that buried many European ideals, as well as millions of bodies, the analogy between the Homer and the Bible lost a lot of its force. The impact of the Parry-Lord intervention lay not in its attack on the sacred unity of the Homeric poems, but a repositioning of these texts within the intellectual and cultural landscape. Archaic epic was now to be thought of principally as the object of ethnological interest, rather than as a wellspring of European culture. We were enjoined to look upon these poems down an anthropological telescope, in the same way that anthropological field workers studied the Slavic Guzlars. In the course of the 20th century, European philologists increasingly constructed themselves as dispassionate purveyors of secular historical truth, in implied contrast to those studying the Bible and other Near Eastern cultures, whose agenda is, or at least was constructed by classicists to be, to explore, ground, confirm, and so forth, the sacred truths of Judeo-Christian scripture. So the oralization of the Homeric poems was part of the process of the defamiliarization of the Greeks that had begun in the late 19th century with Nietzsche, Rhoda, Harrison, and others. It was also recognizably part of this older culture, the legacy of the analysts, the Wolfian heresy. For Wolf too, the poems were, as we have them, a composite of earlier variant oral performances pasted together in the post-archaic period. Now, in the 21st century, these polls still structure academic debate around the Homeric poems. Few would occupy the extremes of these debates. The labour has been directed instead towards creating a kaleidoscopic variety of intermediate positions. So we have, for example, Martin West arguing that the Iliad is the product of one poet, certainly, but that the same poet revised the work in the course of his own lifetime. So it's unified, but also fragmented. Or take the ideas of Gregory Nash, who claims that the archaic epics are fundamentally oral poems, but unlike Wolf, he sees them as unified oral poems, because, in his view, they were shaped into elegant, coherent wholes over time by successive generations of rhapsodic performers. At the same time, however, a new front has opened up, opposing oralists to neo-analysts. And neo-analysis is a school of thought that's gained ground particularly in Germany and Britain. Its leading light has been Wolfgang Kuhlmann. And despite its misleading name, neo-analysis is first and foremost not a resurrection of 18th, 19th century analytical ideas that the texts were originally patchworks of distinct texts. What neo-analysis does is to argue that parts of the poems allude to alternative versions or pre-existing poems. So most famously, the death of Patroclus at Hector's hands in the Iliad is held to allude to the death of Antilochus at Memnon's hands in the Aethiopis, or at any rate, a now lost poetic version of the Memnon story that may have preceded the Aethiopis. The underlying claim here, which has been heavily disputed by hardline oralists, is that the poetic culture that produced the Iliad and the Odyssey did rest on a sophisticated conception of the poem as a coherent text. Neo-analysis can be thought of as, in effect, a form of intertextuality. The Iliad not only borrows from the story of Memnon in this account, but it actually alludes to it, so that when listeners hear the death of Patroclus in the Iliad, they pick up on the death of Memnon. They know what's coming next. They know that it means that Achilles will return to the fray in vengeance. This presupposes a high degree of textualization of the poems, a degree that neo-analysts have often associated with literate culture, although the model per se doesn't require literacy. So neo-analysis is an attempt to reaffirm the idea of the text, a coherent text, as an aesthetically workable category. Now, I don't want, of course, to dismiss or belittle any of this work, far from it. My aim in this recap has been rather to show how what began as, in effect, a theological debate or an allegorical version of a theological debate emerging out of the Protestant Reformation, a debate about the unity or fragmentation of sacred scripture, has gradually metamorphosed into the debates that still occupy us today. The terms have, of course, become secularized. The wider issues have shifted to cross-pollination with other disciplines, such as linguistics and ethnology. But essentially, we're still asking whether it makes sense to see the poems as originally unified texts or as snapshots of a vast, now hidden panorama of oral variants. The sacred charge has disappeared, at least from the surface of the discussion, so no one speaks now of the oral heresy, for example, or of a warfare against the Bible covertly prosecuted via a proxy attack on Homer, but the terms remain much the same. What's more, if we scratch the surface, there's still a kind of reverential awe for the Homeric poems. But what's really at stake in many modern discussions is largely how good these poems are, or rather good how, good in what ways. And the aesthetic beatification of these poems is the residue of the sacred that has survived the process of secularization. We still need Homer to be some kind of fountainhead or wellspring. So my friend and colleague Simon Goldhill has recently described the Iliad as the foundation of Western literature at the start of a performance of the entirety of the poem at the Almeida, a performance that of course plays directly to the textual coherent model. It is actually saying the Iliad is one text. Goldhill justifies this claim to foundationality in terms of the poem's impact on later culture. The Iliad, he writes, puts in place most of the great themes of Western literature, from power to adultery. Well, okay, but one suspects that Western literature, like every other kind of literature, would have found its way to power and adultery even if the Iliad had not survived. But the point of an utterance like this, which I chose from among many other possible candidates, lies in its rhetorical force, to which overfamiliarity can blind us. We need Homer to be a foundation, sustaining not only Western civilization, but also the architectural metaphor that undergirds the idea of Western civilization. We need him to put in place, again, very sort of physical metaphorical structure here. We need him to put in place the essential Western tropes, because despite 50 years of critique of such terms, we still like to think of Western civilization as an essentializable thing, occupying real space, as tangible and solid. Now, I've been arguing that we need to stop seeing Greek culture, and still less Western culture, whatever that is, in terms of Homeric foundations. Homer is not the Bible. The Bible, too, may not deserve its foundational status, but that's a different issue. Archaic epic was, of course, in many ways designed to project a sense of foundationalism. Homer's Theogony, in particular, is perhaps the most foundationally troped poem in the Greek tradition. From its very opening line, let us begin, Homer, singing from the muses of Helicon, through its prefatory association of being, of beginning rather, archestai, to political rule, archer, to its description of the cosmos as formed, how first proto, the gods and the lands came into being. But this is a rhetorical claim, it's not an objective description. Hesiod's Theogony was, of course, not the first such poem. It rested on all sorts of precedents, both in Greek poetry, now lost, and Near Eastern, some of which survived most famously in the case of the Babylonian Enuma Elish. Nor was it the last such poem. This poetry was, like that of Homer, selected, refined, shaped, honed, institutionalized, and performed in such a way as to suggest that it emerged at a primal point in Greek culture, generated by nothing but the force of its own artistic brilliance and the divine aid of the muses. But this is a self-justifying myth. Like the rabbinical Jewish belief that Yahweh revealed the Torah to Moses, or the Muslim belief that the Quran represents Allah's words as revealed to Muhammad. If we're to attempt a secular analysis of archaic epic, one that gets beyond a fascination with the mystical, we'll need to stop endorsing foundational claims to greatness and cultural agency and start seeing these texts as cogs in a wider cultural machine. Let me just add at this point that I see the question of whether Homer and Hesiod possess any special aesthetic qualities, which is one aspect of the foundational claim, as not just obfuscatory, but downright misleading. Of course, at one level, we can take it for granted that these are endlessly rich, exciting, powerful texts that have been continuously reread and repaid rereading for over 2.5 millennia. But the Iliad, at any rate, is also a repetitive macho chest-banging about men and war. And it may be to some people's taste, but it's not objectively good. Many readers hate it, and perhaps with good reason. But in any case, that's not the point. Whatever claims one reader or another may make for its relevance or its irrelevance, these aren't the issue for us in cultural historical times. What matters is the agency granted to the poem within the Greek cultural system. Now, the restrictive focus on the origins of the poem, that's to say how they were composed, in my view, distracts attention away from crucial questions of cultural function. It's not just that these questions are unanswerable in our current state of affairs. They're actually, in one sense, wrong-headed, because the Homeric and Hesiodic poems strategically mystify their own origins. That's part of the cultural power that they claim. We're not supposed to understand precisely where they come from. Homer, specifically, is a designedly absent presence, a name that claims an author function while simultaneously disguising it. The name is not a common Greek one. It's attested very rarely, except in relation to the putative author of the Iliad and the Odyssey. It's fair enough to say, I think, that if the name hadn't been attached to the name to the poems, the Iliad and the Odyssey, no one else in antiquity, or even in the Simpsons, would have borne it. There is a Greek word, homeros, of course, meaning hostage, but why it's been applied to this poem, no one knows, and no one knew in antiquity either, although much fun's had guessing why. An alternative etymology, of course, was homeros, the thigh, according to one late version, because the poet supposedly had a shaggy batch of hair on one of his legs. But the crucial feature about Homer's name is an absence. It's an absence of a patronymic or a geographical descriptor. Now, I may be wrong, but as far as I know, this absence makes him unique amongst famous ancient Greeks. Greeks of the archaic era almost always bore a single name, but pragmatically, in real communicative context, that name would always be expanded by other information, the name of the father, the hometown, or indeed their nickname. It is, I submit, unthinkable that a real poet could have gained huge renown in the 7th or 6th century for producing or codifying, or whatever model we want to use, such a monumental and celebrated poem, only for his place of origin and his family to be forgotten in this way. Later Greeks created all sorts of biographical traditions for Homer, using fiction and imagination to supplement the gaps, and in so doing were, I submit, playing a game that was invited by the poems themselves. When I refer to poems, I include all the paratextual and peritextual material as well, including, of course, the name of the author. The Iliad and the Odyssey don't make any reference to the names of the author, but I think that's part of the experience of these poems, is that the name, the author function attached to them. When we now consider the Iliad and the Odyssey, we're prompted to wonder where they come from. The creator poet seems to be indexed in the poetry itself. The narrator of the Odyssey refers to himself in the first line, "Tell me muse," and that of the Iliad in the second preface, "Tell me now muses." Further narratorial intrusions like apostrophe, when the narrator turns to address one of the characters, and judgments on the behaviour of one of the characters, so fool, four, and so forth. These are relatively uncommon, but they serve as periodic articulations of a distinctive subjectivity behind the poem. We're supposed to think that there is an agency behind these poems. But for all of the personalisation of the narrative voice, there is no distinctive identification of the author of the Homeric poems, as there is in Hesiod. I should add at this point, for the purpose of completeness, that the narrator of the Homeric poems at no point discloses even a gender, so that an Homeric narrator could, in principle, be female. I think ancient readers would have been likely to have associated the narrator of the poems with the author function with the name of Homer himself. So I think it's probably legitimate for us to use the male pronoun when referring to this narrator figure. But even so, it's worth bearing this in mind. And this "now you see me, now you don't" game with the identification of the author is part of the poem's design. Not only do we moderns wonder where these poems came from, ancient consumers would have surely done so as well. The suppression of a place of origin is surely, as Whitmarsh argues, part of an agenda to pan-Hellenize the poems, to make them accessible to anyone from Crete to Macedonia and from Corfu to Lesbos. But it does more than this. It makes a mystery of the poem's origins, even as the poems themselves, with their first-person narratorial markers, invite that speculation by creating this distinctive authorial persona. So the will to reconstruct origins is actually prompted from within the poems themselves, on my reading. They were always already constructed as immemorial poems, semi-opaque, mysterious products of a distant time, a time just over the horizon, located somewhere between the here and now of performance and the otherness of heroic antiquity. But this pastness is, let me emphasise, a dynamic, crafted effect of the poems themselves, designed to impress an audience in the here and now. It's not simply an inert trace of real antiquity and real origins in the poems. The muses, too, contribute to the strategy of mystification. In my first lecture, I considered how the account of their gift of the stick to Hesiod in the Theogony was designed to create a point of connection between the rhapsodic stick-wielding performer in the here and now and the primal author-creator Hesiod. We can extend that analysis. The rhapsodic creator, performer of an archaic epic, in general, in the present, indexes the author-creator Homer or Hesiod, a more or less indeterminate figure occupying a position in the distant past. But that author-creator himself is also an index of a higher form of creation in the divine realm. And let me stress at this point that I don't see this in terms of inspiration, in terms of the mystical revelation of sacred truth, in the way that, for example, José González does in his recent book on the Rhapsodes. Even Plato's Ion, with its model of magnetic contiguity, where the muse infects the Homer, who infects the Rhapsode, who infects the audience, even Plato's Ion doesn't make any kind of claim along those lines in terms of revealed truth. This seems to be alien to the world of Homeric poetry and performance. There's no evidence whatsoever that people listening to Homer felt they were accessing any kind of sacred truths, at least until late antiquity. Let's remember, of course, that the muses aren't mainstream Greek deities, but it seems formerly obscure nymph-like figures who were regionalized, who were then repurposed as general patrons of archaic epic. That's to say, the muses don't represent the divine in general, the godhead, or any particular prophetic capacity. Their one function in these poems is to ally with the creator poet in the mystified narrative of poetic imagination. What the muses do offer the listener in performance, however, is a sense that rhapsodic performance stands as a proxy, tangible and visible here in the present, but a proxy for an older, more powerful, more primal form of creativity displaced into the past. That older act of invention is doubly figured, both as the authorial act of a human creative genius and as the divine intervention of the muses. The two operate in tandem as a kind of hendiadys, Homer and the muses, Hesiod and the muses. But the crucial point is this: the evocation of an originary creative act is not in any sense a lingering trace of the real process of creation behind the epic poems. It's designed solely for the purpose of enhancing the performative moment by referring to, or indexing, to use the Jellian terminology of my first lecture, the original moment of creation. Audiences are led to infer, or abduct, using Jell's term again, the designing presence of the muse-inspired author as part of the performance scenario. But while that tells us a lot about how this poetry may have been received in performance, it tells us nothing about how it was originally generated. All of this doesn't mean, of course, that it's wrong or foolish to ask how the epics came into being, but it does, I would submit, mean that this is not necessarily the only question that we can ask, and certainly not the most important one. In particular, let me propose, perhaps recklessly, three principles that could perhaps guide further discussion. Firstly, ancient audiences of Homer and Hesiod would have known no more than we do about the processes whereby these poems were created. Secondly, the fiction of a moment of original creation is an integral part of the poem's design. All ancient audiences that we can meaningfully imagine would have received these poems together with a myth of origination in the distant past. And finally, as a result of the first two propositions, we should put out of mind any conception of an ur-performance scenario, an original performance scenario that predates the rhapsodic one. There was no pure moment of origination in the poetry when a creator confronted an audience for which he was creating. The question of the origins of the Homeric poems is, of course, inviting precisely because it presents itself as a conundrum veiled in antique inscrutability. But the conundrum is, I would argue, part of the point. So what I've been arguing in the course of these lectures is that if we change the angle of vision a little, we can perhaps accept that we know more about what archaic epic is for, what it does, than we tend to think. The archaic epics are not part of a primal or ur-world that we glimpse distantly, but they're an intrinsic part of the world of the polis. And that itself, of course, is not particularly controversial, for as I've mentioned before, scholars since Moses Finney at least have readily accepted that the Iliad and the Odyssey tell us more about the society in which they circulated than the events that they describe. But let's focus a little bit more on the two areas where I think more can be done. Firstly, performance. We know quite a lot, actually, about the performance of poetry and other literature, particularly from the 5th century onwards. We know, for example, that in the public world, symphonic performance was different. Elaborate costume and props were used to distinguish the performer from the audience. and his fictional world from the real-life world. The mask was a distinctive feature of Athenian tragedy and comedy, a sign that specific generic conventions applied here. I've argued that the stick and the cloak played a similar role for the rhapsode. We also know that elaborate poetic language and distinctive metrical forms were used, as in Pindar, for example, as an analogous means of highlighting marked speech, which is to say forms of pronouncement that claimed a higher cultural value and a generalizable truth. I haven't discussed epic language much, but it seems to me that a case could be made that the distinctive features of epic, archaisms, eolicisms, and of course, above all, oral formulae, might be considered less as fossilized relics of a prehistoric poetic discourse and more as elevating tropes, akin to the Doricisms of tragic lyric, the artfully selected hapax legomena of Hellenistic poets, poetics, or even the Atticisms of orators of the second sophistic. I don't mean, of course, to suggest that such features are mere adornments devoid of any meaning, nor that they have no traces of antiquity, but that they may have been maybe profitably thought of as artfully and deliberately placed in such a way as to communicate the idea of extreme antiquity. In particular, we know a fair amount about the psychology of performance in the 5th century. We know that audiences were capable of a sophisticated conception of the actor as both within and without the fictional world at the same time. There's a famous story preserved in Aulus Gellius, a Latin writer of the 2nd century CE, about the 5th century Athenian actor Polus. Polus, it said, played the role of Electra in Sophocles' play, a role that required him to handle the urn containing the ashes, supposedly, of Orestes. In reality, the urn that he used contained the ashes of his own recently deceased son. The audience, aware of this, wept openly. The story, whether true or not, is a neat exemplification of the double consciousness required by a theatrical audience. You need to be able to read that grief you see on stage as both that of Polus for his son and that of Electra for her brother. Gellius writes, he filled everywhere, not with the appearance and imitation, but with real grief and living laments. The interesting phrase that shows, points up the relationship between the real and the imaginary here that flips it around and plays with it. Ismene Lada Richards aptly cites in connection with the Polus story Dicaeopolis' words in Aristophanes' Acharnians, where he attempts to take on the role of Telephus in Euripides' play. Dicaeopolis writes, "For I must this day seem to be a beggar, be who I am, and yet not seem to be." The two sides of the acting self, the self, the actor, and his role, coexist in the same person, the simultaneity indicated by the balance in men. Their construction. This, I think, provides us with a model for thinking about the rhapsode as two things at once, both the embodiment of the ancient poetic tradition he indexes and a real figure in the here and now, a material body available to our emotional, intellectual, and sensory cognition. It's not just that he's a conduit or a transmitter of an ancient truth, a passive agent who simply mediates poetic ideas from long ago. That, of course, is the model presupposed in Plato's Ion. But, of course, Plato's none too subtle aim is to diminish the authority of the rhapsode and the agency, his agency, as a vehicle of cultural authority. It is also, in effect, the Homer's Bible model that's gripped Western scholarship for so long. The rhapsode is an actor-performer, the index of all indices, the active agent, who claims the authority to belong polis-like at once to our world and that of the mythical past. That's why it's been so important for my argument to think of the stick and the cloak as semiotically fungible, as belonging simultaneously to our world and that of the past. And really do. It's not simply a question that the poet is somehow embodying and mediating something from the past. They really are two things at once, the cloak and the staff. They're tokens of great power. So that's performance. The second area on which to focus is identity. In the last lecture, I argued that the Iliad and the Odyssey gained cultural centrality in the archaic period because they told the interlocking story about resistance to intermarriage and the emotional appeal of a peninsular identity. This, I argued, set them against both the competitor epics, particularly the Argonautica with its story of long-distance commerce, intermarriage and the production of hybrid children, the mix of barbaroi, and it set them against the real world of Mediterranean colonization, which was threatening to conjure new forms of belonging overseas, new modes of affiliation to different lands, and new hybridizations of identity. Again, I think we can see the Homeric poems not as products of a world that lies somewhere over the horizon of Greek history, a world that needs to be reconstructed through guesswork and intuition, but as part of a continuous Greek tradition as a whole. In particular, the Greeks throughout their history used narratives of travel and return to express models of identity, normative models of identity. The most obvious example is that of the literary form that we call the Greek novel, or the Greek romance, which flourished from the first century CE. Its preeminent practitioners were Chariton, Achilles Tatius, Longus, and Heliodorus. In the standard romance format, it's found in the earliest romances, Chariton and Xenophon of Ephesus, a young Greek couple fall in love in a Greek city, and then are, for whatever reason, sent off abroad, usually separated. After much perilous adventure in that terrifying environment, they're reunited back in the Greek city. This paradigm combines the normative promotion of the Greek city as the optimal environment for civilized living with the emotional and sexual appeal of union with the beloved. In the later novels, however, more complex identity models are produced. The most extreme example is Heliodorus's Chariton and Theagenes. And this work, produced probably in the 4th century CE, begins in medias res in the middle of the story, with the early parts recounted in flashback later on. As we begin the novel, we encounter a white couple stranded on the shores of Egypt, where barbarian bandits capture them. Presently, under interrogation, they identify themselves as a brother and sister from the city of Ephesus. Now, we've had enough generic markers at this point in the narrative, and indeed enough indirect allusions, sorry, direct allusions to Achilles Tatius, to allow us to assume that this will be a romance in the conventional mode. But as the plot unfurls, we discover that they are not, in fact, two Greeks whose destiny is to return home to a Greek city. One of them is certainly a Greek, in fact, he couldn't be more Greek, he's a descendant of Achilles. The other, however, is the daughter of an Ethiopian royal couple. She was born white as a result of a freak accident at the moment of conception. Her mother happened to look at a painting of a white girl, Andromeda, at the critical moment of conception, and that, as we all know, leads to strange effects. As a result, their journey will not be back to a Greek city, but to the land of Chariclea's birth in Ethiopia, where she'll be reunited with her parents and married to her Greek husband. Heliodorus' romance makes heavy and continued reference to the Odyssey. At one point, they sail past the island of Zakynthos, which Heliodorus, interestingly and as far as I know, exceptionally identifies as the true location of Homer's Ithaca. And Odysseus appears to one of the characters in a dream. In the course of this dream manifestation, Odysseus predicts that the lovers will experience the same things as me, and in particular offers Penelope's blessing to Chariclea, the female protagonist. On another occasion, the Egyptian priest Calasarius, who guides the lovers for part of the story, offers a fanciful biography of Homer, who he claims to have been Egyptian like him. This, in fact, is the origin of the etymology that I mentioned earlier, the one which derives Homer's name from Homeros, the thigh, because of the shaggy patch of hair. Now, Heliodorus' version of the romance of Odysseus and Penelope turns the narrative of peninsular identity on its head. Homer is now reinvented as an Egyptian priest. Penelope now becomes, or at least Penelope as she is reenacted in the story, becomes not a Greek, but an Ethiopian. The marriage that is enshrined at the end marks not the return to the peninsular normality, but the hybridization of Greek and non-Greek. And not just of Greek and non-Greek, but also of black and white. Now, black and white is signified not primarily in racial terms, for the ancient Mediterranean world didn't obsess about skin pigmentation as a marker of racial difference in the way that we do. After all, most people were shades of brown in that environment. But primarily, as semiotic poles, black and white in this text exist to be as far differentiated from each other in colour terms as they possibly could be. So the distinctive claim of Chariclea of Theagenes is that it takes a romance narrative designed to instill an emotional connection to the Greek man, the Odyssey, and a normative model for Greek-Greek marriage, for peninsular ethnic marriage, and turns it inside out. For Heliodorus, a paradigmatic model of the romance involves not only the radical recentering of the world, which is nicely exemplified by the Ethiopian king's reference at one point to Delphi as the edge of the world. He says, you know, they've come from Delphi, right at the edge of the world. Interesting inversion. It's not just that recentering, but it's also the fusion of two radically other beings, figured in coloured terms as the black and the white. Now, Heliodorus sat at the other end of antiquity from Homer, antiquity being, of course, an arbitrary chronological periodization, but let's let that go for now. Heliodorus was, he tells us in a postscript, from a priestly clan in the Syrian town of Emesum, known to us now as Homs, the site of terrible battles in the bloody civil war of the modern state, but famous in antiquity as the birthplace of the Empress Julia Domno, who married the first black African emperor, Septimius Severus, and the origin of the conical stone worshipped under the name of El Jebel, El of the Mountain, in Rome. The stone that gave its name to Julius and Septimius' most outlandish son, Elagabalus. Heliodorus was, we can be sure, knowingly revising the Odyssean romance paradigm for a new era, a Roman one, in which new models of pan-Roman identity were offered as superseding older ones that were based in locality. We can recall that the Emperor Caracalla had announced universal franchise in 211 CE. Now, it is, of course, tempting to see what Heliodorus was doing as fundamentally, substantially different to what Homer was doing in the Odyssey. Heliodorus was the product of a highly sophisticated age with 1,000 years of written culture behind him. His intertextual dialogue with the past included not just Homer, but also Euripides, Sophocles, Plato, Herodotus, and many others, as well as more recent writers like Lucian and Achilles Tatius. Now, it's certainly true that Heliodorus is not the same as the Odyssey, but the Odyssey, too, is a parable of Greek identity, and it shares many techniques with the Greek novel. Not just, I submit, because the Greek novel is heavily influenced by the Odyssey, but because both kinds of texts are at one level doing the same kind of thing. They're generating narratives of cultural belonging by annexing with that sense of belonging to the land to parallel stories about the fulfillment of sexual desire within the socially sanctioned space of marriage. The Odyssey is not, to be sure, a Greek romance, and the cultural factors that shape the emergence of the Greek novel in the form of the Roman Empire are very different to those of archaic Greece. But the Odyssey is better understood, I would submit, in terms of its similarities to and differences from the Greek novel than by imagining a prehistoric world of song that lies beyond our horizons. To understand the Homeric poems, I think we need to move away from biblically influenced models that, however much they've been adapted and transformed over the last 150 years, still exert a force in the academy. I've suggested that cultural history can offer us new models, and particularly a cultural history focused on performance and reception, on the material, sensory and emotional impact of performance in the here and now, and on the evidence that we can compile from later periods about how the Greeks performed, conceived of, and enacted performance and narrative. But that's enough from me. Let me just say in conclusion how much I've enjoyed the opportunity to think through these ideas with you, and how grateful I am to have spent this time in this wonderful department and deeply enriching experience. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Tim. I've been pondering over the last week this really rather novel suggestion of Homeric epics sort of represent or articulate a peninsular identity that's resisting against this awful colonial intermarriage and everything. And I just don't know that I agree by it.
Okay.
And for two reasons. Firstly, as I sort of hinted last week, I don't think Ithaca can be seen as central or peninsular in any sense. The only reason a non-Ithaca would have to go to Ithaca is if he's on his way to Puglia, and as part of a network that goes up the Ionian Sea. Secondly, outside of Athens, and outside of the literary tradition, which is really only one part of what you're calling the archaic Greek cultural system, I'm not sure that Homeric epics actually enjoy that sort of centrality that you're attributing to them in the archaic period. Now, a classic example here would be Cleisthenes of Scythia, who decides to ban Homeric recitations and gets rid of the Dresdos because these are thought to be too Argive. Right? But then when you actually go over the mountains into the Argolid, you find out that before the 5th or 4th centuries, they're really uninterested in Homeric. I mean, they had everything to capitalize on. You know, Agamemnon at Mycenae, I die in Indies, but they don't. They're not at all interested in that. They take their cultural influences far more from the base. And when you go down to Laconia, you've got tombs of Agamemnon, so they don't think about the Homeric Agamemnon at all. Thessaly has no interest
in this. Why do you say they're not thinking of the Homeric Agamemnon when they've got tombs of Agamemnon?
Because he's thought of as being the king of Sparta.
Right.
But you go up to Thessaly, they're not really interested because they're not mentioned. The Thessalians aren't mentioned in Rome, neither are the West Locrians. So I just don't know that this cycle is quite as central to archaic Greek culture as you want.
Okay, so on the first point about Ithaca, now, when I say peninsular identity, I don't mean necessarily literally
but
the mainland.
It's a little off-centre.
But it's a little off-centre, but it's part of the... I mean, you were saying it's a transitional point towards Apulia. So yes, I mean, there are all sorts of routes in multiple different directions, but it's part of the system that's connected to the mainland, and it's not... and of course, Odysseus is a... he's a pan-Hellenic hero. He's somebody who is kind of recognised across Greek mainland. He's a name to conjure with, isn't he? So, the literal location in Ithaca, the physical geographical location in Ithaca, isn't my overriding point here. The point is that you have a nexus of song traditions that are located, that are where all the main protagonists are located at some point connected to the mainland. Now, of course, there are island identities, and island identities are different. There's something like, you know better than me, something like 1,200 inhabited islands in the archaic period. But this fragmentation of the Greek landscape is also part of the reason, I think, for the kind of pan-Hellenic drive, for the need to create some sort of community. So I don't see the geographical position of Ithaca as necessarily problematic. On to your second point. I mean, the Homeric poems did have a kind of currency in the archaic period. I mean, I take all your points, but they're not, the poems that we have were not sort of pan-canonical. They're not canonical in every single environment. But I mean, if we think about something like the Polis Bay cult, kind of suggests some sort of sense of the Odyssey being a kind of, something like the Odyssey being.
Well, it really doesn't, because the inscribed dedications to Odysseus don't predate Homeric.
Well, again, better than I do. Nestor's Cup, for example, on Pithecusae. Now, that, of course, that you might argue pushes in the opposite direction because it's a colonial setting rather than a peninsular setting. But again, has been taken to suggest some sort of knowledge of the Homeric poems. But even so, my point is not necessarily that the Homeric poems had a kind of universal saturation throughout the Greek mainland, that they were in every stage of the archaic era, that they were the poems that they would be in the Hellenistic era, that kind of the central poems of Greek culture. I would say that they exist in order to be that the poems that we have reading these poems suggest that these poems have in them that sort of pull, that centrifugal kind of pull towards the mainland, that eventually generated that sense of cultural centrality, that have a will to cultural centrality. But it stands to reason that they didn't always have that cultural centrality, and that their part of their journey during the archaic was a journey from relative obscurity to centrality.
So this actually backs up your point in a way, that they weren't born into the world central foundational sacred. They were one among other traditions, and we look at it and we see it in a distorted way, based on what we have done.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so I think it would be great to be able to tell the story in more detail, but clearly, you know, there is a part of the story of the formation of the Homeric poems is not just how they came to be the shape that they are now, but how they came to adopt that sort of cultural position and how the institutional factors shifted them from margins to centre.
Thank you very much. I very much enjoyed the suggestion of emphasizing performance and reception. I realize there's nothing more tiresome than people sticking up for their own corpora, but I do have to say that we do have a very good, very robust collection of archaic responses to these things in the form of iconography, both monumental and ceramic of the period. Some of which might actually go a bit with Jonathan's question. If one looks at the iconography as prominent in the 17th and 16th centuries, it's really, yes, there's Homer, but there's also the other epics that are very prominent in monumental sculpture elsewhere. But even more productively, though, it seems that one can actually use the iconography to test some of the readings that one has of the poems. For example, if one's interested in the relationship of how people took the death of Patroclus, one can document certainly kinds of allusions and like in the text, but also one can look to see how they're represented. Mm. The thing they really pair with the death of Memnon, for instance, is actually death of Sarpedon, which are shown in very distinctive kind of paired iconographies. I don't know what that means, but there's something there that might be a kind of body of data that one could put alongside the textual that could, I think, really enrich the discourse.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much for that. So you're saying that the death of Patroclus is put next to, juxtaposed with the death of
Sarpedon? The death of Memnon, actually. I mean, the thing that alludes to the death of Memnon is the death of Sarpedon, not the death of Patroclus.
Yeah, okay.
But the death of Patroclus, probably the most bizarre allusion is actually to Ajax and the sheep. Because you can have one point a ram labeled Patroclus who's being fought over by the ram. So,
I mean, this is an area that is really interesting. I mean, all we see that come to the idea that there's a sort of ping pong of deaths that occur from book 13 onwards. This is Sarpedon, Patroclus, Hector, and then projected into the future death of Achilles himself. And in the sort of the intervening period, there is death of Antilochus at Achilles' hand. Now, we can't read that at the moment until we get to Quintus of Smyrna in the 2nd or 3rd century CE, but Quintus certainly plays his game very quickly. He interweaves all of those deaths into one and says, look, you know, this is how you sort it out. Basically, you've got a series of reciprocal deaths, and then you've got Achilles killing lots of people. So Achilles kills Penthesilea, Achilles kills Hector, Penthesilea, and Antilochus. And so the pattern changes. Yeah. But people are very much aware that this sort of, as I say, the sort of ping-pong effect of, you know, one death leads to another is part of the springy narrative dynamic of the lead-up to the fall of Troy.
Yeah. And all that makes sense is that the sculptors and the painters are in some ways analogous to Heliodorus in the sophistication of their response, but have the virtue of being a different time period.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Not coming out as well, and the question is, I terms of earlier New Eastern sources, and even more like Homer in terms of Hittite material and so on, that there is just this continuing idea of, you know, we can either pretend that Homer is Greek and this is pure Greek and there's nothing behind it, or we've got all these other ways of saying, well, there's this bigger world that it's part of that's not really Greek at all in any sense.
Yeah, very interesting. Of course, Martin West would think that Homer was bilingual, and he sort of spoke Greek and Akkadian, and that's how he sort of got his access to the New Eastern material that Martin West thinks is actually sort of in the Iliad and Odyssey. Whether you want to posit that as your model, I mean, it's clear that the Homeric and Hesiodic poems have a lot of sort of forelager behind them. That there's a great sort of Near Eastern body of material that goes into these poems. What's interesting, I think, about them is the relative denial of that the way the poems present themselves as or talk to them as products of Greek culture. Hesiod, in particular, that idea that, you know, you farm on the hillside in central Greece gets it all from the muses. That's almost a way of saying, you know, I didn't get anything from kind of Babylonian influence or whatever. It's a sort of a denial of that. It sort of reminds me a little bit of Bakhtin's point about heteroglossia. Bakhtin thinks that all language is polyglottic, all language is sort of constantly engaged in dialogue with other forms and so forth. There's no way of being that is not in dialogue with other people and other potentialities and other cultures and so forth. But there are ways of repressing that and presenting yourself as though you were. So, you know, kind of Hitler's Nuremberg rallies or whatever are not sort of polyglottic speeches, but they are speeches that radically repress the innate polyglottic nature of discourse. So I would say that, not to compare it at all with that, honestly, but I would say that the Homeric poems are similarly participating in a very fluid, interconnected world, and the Hesiodic poems, but they are also trying to clamp down on the multifaceted nature of that, and trying to present themselves as autochthonous, self-generated, intrinsically peninsula Greek models of identity. I know Jonathan would agree with that. But that's, I mean, it seems to me that that's how you explain the fact that there is non-Greek material in there, and at the same time explain why Homer doesn't say, you know, his bit of intersectionality with, you know, Gilgamesh or whatever, or he was Gilgamesh coming along or anything like that, is because it's specifically designed to execute one.
I mean, it doesn't necessarily have to see that as a gesture of mystification.
Gesture of?
Mystification.
Right.
I mean, could one sort of see that as the kind of sort of incipient sort of will to universality that's already imminent in the poems that gets cashed out by the philosophical uptake, as opposed to Odyssey in particular? There's a kind of, it's a will to universality that's sort of in the poem. But you don't necessarily need to see it as kind of, within the lens of a kind of hermeneutics of suspicion. What's at stake for you in seeing it then?
Yes. Well, I would say that there is a universalism in the Homeric poems, and that's partly, I mean, even my model, which is less universal than what you're suggesting, would accept that, because, I mean, the Odyssey, I would say, is not just about being an Ithaca, but obviously it's about being part of a kind of broader space. So you have to actually move allegorically from a model that says that, you know, it's great to be back home with your wife in Ithaca to a model that says it's great to be back home, you know, rooted to your soul wherever in the Greek world you are. But the question of whether that...
And then the philosophical tradition will say, well, it's about, you know, the soul's process of
So by the time we get to late antiquity, which is coeval with Heliodorus and that sort of thing, when people are getting these sort of universalizing trends in, then you do get these readings. And your question is, I suppose, whether just as I was saying that that the Odyssey is participating in the kind of framework that Heliodorus is participating in, but doing it the other way around, whether you could do a similar sort of thing with the Odyssey as a narrative of what it is to be a human being. But again, I think that you can do that, because that opening line, the hand and wine of the Musa, tell me of, you know, what it is to be a human being, a male human being, whatever, it does seem to be striking some sort of particular gesture, and then you get the adjectives after that that sort of perhaps specify it to the point where we actually get in 921, where it is the name of Odysseus himself. But we start out, the gesture does seem to be, tell me what it is to be a man and a husband. The only qualification I would give to that is that I would say that universalism is always culturally positioned. So when you say anyone, you usually mean anyone with certain exclusions or anyone with certain, I think a true form of universalism is very hard to achieve.
Oh, no doubt. But I guess how much your own sort of mode of historicization is desired to disacknowledge that in the past.
To disacknowledge?
Yeah.
Really? Yeah, okay. Give me an example.
Well, I don't mean that sounds ludicrous. I mean, I don't mean to sort of take it back. Is the will to universalize the Odyssey an illegitimate history of interpretation that you want to kind of, go back before? Or if not, what do you learn from thinking about? You can call them kind of exclusionary, exclusion of localness and all of that stuff. The moment of the humans, that's
by exclusion of localness, you mean?
Well, the things that you were talking about just now, the kind of disavow of whatever it is.
Sort of Babylonian stuff.
Even if one thinks of that just in terms of the kind of way.
Yeah. Yes, well, I mean, I have offered one kind of reading which suggests that the frame in which we should analyse this is in terms of this sort of peninsula identity and resistance to intermarriage. So that model of reading, I suppose you might say, wouldn't necessarily survive a universalising reading. If you say that these poems are essentially about the human condition and that they are equally open to anyone as long as they can read the language, and I suppose that is a big condition, isn't it? Language is.
I just think that in terms of your Bible Homer thing, you might sort of revise that. I mean, a text can be made sort of foundational, in spite of it's constantly about sort of localisms. There's a different process of working in the way in which the Homer texts get to be important, right? If not foundational.
Yeah. I'm still not absolutely clear what you're doing with universalization, though, because it seems to me that all of that process of sort of shifting the Homeric text towards cultural centrality is about positioning them towards a Greek centrality, and that becomes more and more acute when you move into the Hellenistic and Roman periods, when Greek militarism rubs up against other forms of militarism, and Greek efforts become ways of defining the Greeks as not just winners in the Trojan War, but also losers against the Romans, and that sort of thing. So,
I'm sort of thinking back from the very end of it, which I get to sort of next thing, maybe it's more of an interesting thing.
I wanted to ask a question, can I go in?
Yeah.
It seems to me a little bit that you alluded to this in the Ecclesiastical tradition, but I think you alluded to it as a sort of a separate thing, this is not the thing we're talking about.
Right.
And yet, a lot of the things you about Homer, it seems to me that you could import right into a talk about the Athenists. I was really interested in what you were saying about the absent presence of the name.
Right.
But it's really the Athenists who plays that game to the hilt, right? And the others all do too. It's a little mind-bending for me to think simply by not having a name in there, which seems like a very subtle way of pivoting. You know, there's so much work now on Theognis' poetry and other poetry, and supposedly we need a game about impersonation and entry and exiting. And is this authority, is it writing, or is it a different kind of taking on of a tradition? Is it in a certain way, I mean, is that a helpful paradigm for what I think we're trying to do to Homer? To kind of bring it, not to bring it into the symposium, which seems to be incorrect, but to bring it into a game that's enthusiastic.
Well, except that I wouldn't see it necessarily as a game in quite the same way. I mean, the symposic world is a world of play. But, I mean, Naj actually said that, drew the analogy between Archilus and Anacreon and so forth, and Homer and Hesiod, in the sense that he sees that any poet or any performer who takes on that identity as in the sense of inhabiting that role. So he would see that as a kind of world, as a kind of continuity. But from my point of view, the author function in Homer and Hesiod is designed in order to, as I say, to index this idea of primal creation. And I don't think that's necessarily quite the case with Anacreon. I don't think you have quite the same sense that when you perform a piece of Anacreon, you might well be playing with all sorts of forms of identity, and now you see me, now you don't, you know, who am I Anacreon or not? You're not saying, you know, Anacreon, the great poet, is the part of, you know, the tradition.
So the other absence is not to make you think about whether there's an author, it's to make you think that this is an authorless, thoughtful piece of work.
Well, I don't know about authorless, it's a very distinctive kind of author, isn't it? I mean, the absent presence of the name of Homer, or Hesiod for that matter, although Hesiod is arguably more present.
He gets names.
He gets names, that's right, yeah. But both of these roles are designed to give a sort of distant foundational ballast to the poems, which is then indexed at the moment of performance. And
it's so fundamentally different that the name is not in performance. It's a strange, I mean,
yeah.
I've never really thought of it that much, but it's a strange separation.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, I mean, of course, it's all speculative at that level, isn't it? Because we don't know when the name became attached to the poems, and we don't know whether they could have been caught without the name attached to them, but it's still, I mean, this might be as really worth countering with this fact that Homer is the most famous poet of the Archaic period, and the poet for whom the central thing that everyone always says about Homer is that there's no birthplace attached to him, there's no father or whatever. So this is what inspires all of these linguistic traditions. It seems to me to be something that is there as part of the peritextual material that floats around the Homeric poems, that is doing something, and that something is to do with saying this is a work of deep antique mystery that has an author function to it. We need that author function, but we also need the erasure and the invisibility of that author.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
I
have a question that maybe sort of inspired by this discovery of these notebooks in which the draft that the King James filed.
Oh, yeah.
You said at one point that we should stop thinking about these various aspects of Homeric language, both the as it were, morphological aspects as well as poetic aspects, the training line and so on, as sort of fossilized bits that get received in the late Archaic and early classical period, but they are part of the toolkit by which the performer, you know, announced to his audience, look at the outperforming ancient poem. I suppose the joke about the King James Bible is where does the highly formal and somewhat artificial language of the King James Bible come from? And I actually knew people once who said it was given, but I got the King James. But now we know it was then in Cambridge last Tuesday.
Right.
But we have this, you know, more or less easily dated manuscript. It's hard not to hear your claim about how we should think about that language and ask, well, what are the implications of picking you up on this? Was this language then always already marked as the language of archaic poetry? I mean, was it to an audience in say 470 and 500 and 530 and 570 always marked in exactly the same way? Presumably you wouldn't say this, that every auditor throughout the late archaic period was always hearing it as the language actually of yesterday. It was never a contemporaneous language. Or is that the claim that you would make? That it,
I would say it's an interlocking package, isn't it? That that the dactylic hexameter is the crucial medium here, and that once you've got the sort of blend of the Ionic and the Aeolic, you've got the hapaxes, you've got the formulaic structure, and so forth, then that becomes part of the architecture. And again, you know, go back to Quintus Smollett, a really interesting poet from the second century BCE. I mean, it is actually replicable throughout Greek history. I mean, Quintus is not exactly the same as Homer. You know, anyone who knew Homer wouldn't be fooled by the line of Quintus. But you know, the point is, you can actually be Homer. You can, you know, if you want to be Homer, if you want to kind of address your language in a Homeric style, you can do it. So,
you evaded my question by leaving forward. I was asking you to think about, you know, something like the first century and a half of Homeric war. So, in continent, what do I know either about Homer or Greg Nelson's about Homer? But, you know, Greg believes that you can locate different versions of it in different places. There's the Corcyrian.
Right.
Right? And there's a Corcyrian text. And on his reading, then, unlike yours, there is not only a radical attempt to historicize the production, but also like to locate specific languages in the text. And on your claim, you know, which is just a possibly sentence in the paper, this language is then presented, we're invited to think about the language as always somebody else's language. That is, every audience experiences it as a specifically poetic language that belongs perhaps to someone else, but certainly in the past. And is that the claim you wish to make about?
Well, I wouldn't construct in such a hard line opposition terms, because I don't think it's particularly controversial to say, I mean, the word Kunstsprache was kind of invented in order to describe Homeric Ionic. You know, everyone knows, everyone accepts that this is a language that is designed in order to impress its readers with a sense of, you know, participating in the generic structure of dactylic hexameter, the world of heroic dactylic hexameter. The question then is how you blend that sort of model with an idea of regional variation, an idea of responsivity to local dialects, and so forth. And I, as I say, I don't see that there's a particular strong opposition there. Nobody speaks in Homeric dactylic hexameters at any point in natural language in Greek antiquity. There are, I mean, almost certainly huge numbers of variants, Iliads going around that inflect in different ways in different times and so forth, but there is still recognisably a family resemblance between them, which is based in this multifaceted combination of meter and language.
Hi, forgive me if you addressed this in your previous lectures, but if we take Homer as stressing this peninsular identity, how are we meant to read the sections of the Iliad that are very sympathetic to the Trojan, especially Hector?
Okay, well, I don't think that the Iliad and the Odyssey are necessarily wall-to-wall about, you know, jingoistically constructing our identity against yours. And you are absolutely right that the Iliad is playing something, playing much more kind of complex game than even than the Odyssey. Like, the Odyssey is at one level about, this is carry on to Ithaca, and it does have that teleological pullback. And Iliad is a very different kind of character. I think in the background of the Iliad is a sort of, I don't want to use the word ethnocentric, but there's a sort of a story there about how to get Helen back home to the mainland and trying to recuperate her. But the Iliad is actually much more about sort of experimenting with the idea of settling in a world that is not your own. So the Greek camp, I would see it as a sort of proxy colony as a sort of attempt to think through what it would be like in this era of American world if you actually founded a colony, and putting that against the Trojan capital and sort of thinking about the two in relationship to each other, thinking about the winners and losers in this, and thinking about what it is to be a settled community. So I don't think that the Iliad, whilst I think the Iliad fits, intersects with this story that I've been telling, it's primarily an Odyssey and story that I think you should know.
Well, that's all. Thank you for your support. Fascinating.